This joint right here, it makes me wanna.
Hello, Wisconsin. You are listening to the Maggie Dawn Show. I'm Maggie Dawn, and I am joined this hour with Representative Evan Goyke, who is running for the City of Milwaukee's City Attorney's Office. Before we took the news at the top of the hour, we were talking about some of your policy objectives, and you mentioned housing. Tell us about what you want to do as City Attorney on housing.
Yeah, this is an issue facing, I think, every community. It's access to affordable housing, ownership opportunities, and where the City Attorney comes in is we're the enforcement and prosecutors for when property owners cut corners and are not living up to the standards. And we have huge numbers of people in Milwaukee paying 30, 40, 50% of their income, and they're living in substandard conditions.
And I just want to emphasize this. For if you don't know, if you've never been poor or you've never been working really hard, but maybe paycheck to paycheck, folks are paying $1,200, $1,300, $1,400, $1,500 a month for insect infested, no heat.
Lead paint, yeah. You know, unsafe conditions.
And you may be thinking, like, how is that possible? Because if you have a slightly spotty rental record.
Right. And it's you know, I know it's warm this winter, but, you know, you can't not have a place to live. If you have little kids, you know, so you have to find a place.
Right.
And so in previous administrations, the City Attorney's Office has really led public efforts to hold bad landlords accountable using a law called receivership, which essentially shortcuts the landlord, takes the rent paid by the tenant to fix up the problems in the property before the landlord gets their share. And it was really effective a couple of years ago. And this current city attorney has basically stopped that practice and stopped that priority. And I am confident that the landlords in my area have not stopped their bad practices and they haven't fixed up all the problems. And so
why do you think that is? Like, what happened?
I have no idea, Maggie. I would love to hear my opponent justify why he has stopped these. And people should just look it up. Just type in, you know, Milwaukee City Attorney receivership, and you'll see. I mean, it was big stories for a couple of years, and these lawyers worked really hard. They set some really important precedent to hold people accountable and to advocate on behalf of some of our poorest, most marginalized residents. And look, I've got no, we're going to go after these guys. A lot of them are out of state, kind of corporate entities hidden by limited liability companies.
LLCs.
That's right. So there's money. People are getting rich on our dime. And I'm not against landlords. I'm not meaning to villainize all landlords, but there is a segment, and they particularly prey on people of color, people of low income in the city of Milwaukee, and we're going to run them out of business.
Yeah, there's about four or five of them. And everybody, any lawyer who walks around the courthouse actually knows who they are, their name, what they look like, because they show up at all the, they used to show up at all the foreclosure sales.
Yeah, and buying a house for $10,000, renting it out for $1,000 a month, not putting any money into it. They're also the eviction kings and queens on a different floor of the courthouse. Yep. So they come to buy a property and kick their tenants out. And it creates this cycle of poverty that's been going on in neighborhoods in Milwaukee and elsewhere. And we're really going to disrupt that. I really want to disrupt this generational poverty. And I think housing plays a critical role in it.
So I want to give you a chance to address your opponent in the city attorney's race. We've talked about accountability for elected officials. We've talked about transparency, that you should be doing this as a public servant to serve others and not yourself. How do you think the city attorney's record stands up to those basic values?
No, he's failed. I don't think he deserves a second term in office. He was elected in 2020. This is the end of his first term. I don't think he should be given another shot. He has never come before the public and taken accountability and admitted that office has had problems. You're talking about major turnover, scandal after scandal, paying out lawsuits. And look, Maggie, when you say this about public service, I think of the, I'm 41. I grew up with a TV that was so heavy that it couldn't be on, like an entertainment system on the floor.
Had the
with
tube.
A turn, yeah,
had
with a the turn dial.
Yes, yeah.
And I swear to God, on the top of that television was a bust of Robert Kennedy. And I grew up in a household that talked about that kind of Kennedy era public service. And I take it very seriously. The public puts their trust in us, in elected officials. I've tried to honor that. I've been elected or reelected 6 times to the legislature. I understand what it means to cast your vote or to represent a community. And I don't think Mr. Spencer has lived up to the standard that we deserve. And I'm going to show him the door on April 2nd.
Midway through his term in June of 2022, the Journal Sentinel reported, so this is just 2 years in, we're now 2 years henceforth, 245 years of experience had left that office. That was 2 years into his administration. What do you make of that?
It wasn't a good place to work. It isn't a good place to work right now. I think it's a toxic work environment. Some of the former attorneys there that have spoken up have described it as such. There are still problems with retention and turnover. There's a number of vacant positions today. And I think you're seeing fewer applications, fewer people. I mean, these people aren't dumb, Maggie. They read the newspaper. If you think about it, you're graduating law school or you're looking for a career change and you're seeing that this guy's put in a dress code, Mad Men era dress code, and you're a young woman, why would you want to go work in that environment?
Yeah, we're going to talk about that in just a second. I want to listen to a clip. So if you're not familiar, if you live in the city of Milwaukee, first of all, go register to vote. Vote.gov. You can figure out where you need to vote. The election's on April 2nd. If you would like more information about the city attorney and about his record, Google City of Milwaukee City Attorney. The gentleman's name is Tierman Spencer. We do not have enough time in 2 hours to go through even half of the articles covering the scandals during this gentleman's tenure. I want to listen to this clip that Calvin found. This is in 2021, so he had been in the office for about a year. But it is basically, and he was under sharp criticism for conflicts of interest, basically biases against his clients, refusing to defend his clients in court, which is his oath and duty as the city's lawyer. There were ethics complaints going on. Here's how Mr. and people were leaving the office in droves. Here's what Mr. Spencer had to say in 2021.
I haven't had an opportunity. Day one, I've been persecuted, and it continued. So why don't we try to have a relationship where I could work with counsel, work with the office, and we can move forward? You know, why don't we try to have a time where we're not always reporting something negative? Then we can start a date. But if we always talking about the negative stuff, things that don't exist, but and trying to perpetuate it, we're going to have a problem. Now, here, I'm going to deviate just slightly to go. We had a lot of exodus because people didn't want to be part of the scrutiny of media. Go through what I have to go through. Why would they want to be in that environment when they can find another environment? So it's a lot of different factors. Now, I'd love for my date to have been day one, but it wasn't. And it isn't now. We still have the same thing going on, unfortunately. So it's...
Any response?
Bring on the scrutiny. If you're a public service, you're paying your salaries paid by the taxpayers. You have this oath to the city, to the state, whatever your position is. That accountability and transparency is part of the job. It's part of holding office.
I couldn't agree with you more. It is not persecution to be held accountable. Transparency and accountability and criticism, even ill-founded criticism, isn't persecution. We got a caller, if you don't mind, Evan.
Let's
Joanne from Madison. Say hello to my friend, Evan Goyke.
Hello. Quick question about shoplifting. If you turn on the right-wing radios, it seems like every city like Milwaukee is filled with shoplifters. You can't go in and be treated like a normal shopper anymore. What would you do about shoplifting in your role as a what will you do about shoplifting in your new role, upcoming role as city attorney?
Yeah, thank you for the caller, for the call, Joanne. And I liked in your voice some, I think, skepticism over the reality that is being portrayed. I have not seen any. I've seen cases that have been sensationalized and maybe headlines generated about the increase of crimes like that. Shoplifting is a Class A misdemeanor, punishable by 9 months or $10,000 or both. That is a crime prosecuted by the district attorney's office. There may be some municipal version of that that I don't think that it's frequently prosecuted by the city attorney's office. You know, we need to have an environment where businesses are safe to conduct business, where shoppers are. As I've mentioned, I think that right now, like in my neighborhood on the north side, we have a focus on the unsafe streets and reckless driving. That's what I'm hearing from my neighbors and residents in my area far more than headlines about shoplifting. But look, we're going to have a close relationship with the police department, with the prosecutor's office, with residents. If it is happening and it is a problem, we're going to hear them, listen to residents, and we're going to address it, and we're going to respond. You know, unlike the clip that was just played, if our office is not handling it, you know, appropriately and people are bringing it to my attention, we will actually address it and change course and do something different that
Imagine
works.
That. You receive critical feedback and then you know, endeavor to do better. I don't know why this is seemingly so complicated for so many people in that hold jobs in the public trust. This is the thing that gets me going, right? If you were working in the private sector and you were not doing your job to the standard that is required for the work, and your boss sits you down and says, hey, this is not, you know, your performance is not adequate, it's not competent, you either do better or get fired. It seems to me that many elected officials these days, when their boss, the public, often speaking through the Fourth Estate and the press, brings a legitimate grievance and criticism, the response is, that's not true. It's someone else's fault. It's just done. I have nothing to do with that. What are you talking
Fake
to me
news.
About? Fake
yeah.
news. Yeah. We'll be back with Representative Evan Goyke after these important messages. We're going to talk about that Supreme Court decision because he is a lawyer as well. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Join us, 855-75-CIVIC. I think what I'm hearing from Representative Goyke, current candidate for the city of Milwaukee city attorney's race, is that the city attorney's office needs to level up. I think that's what I'm hearing. 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. Join the conversation. I was talking about the Supreme Court, and yesterday they just came out and said, oh yeah, we'll take up Donald Trump's claim that he is a king and can't, you know, that he could deploy SEAL Team 6 to take out the city attorney and never face criminal prosecution for that because absolute immunity. You're a lawyer too. You've been a lawyer for a while. What do you make of all this and the Supreme Court's disposition these days?
It's a sad day that, you know, my first reaction is, seems like conservatives always run and attack more liberal candidates as being an activist judge. And I can think of no greater activist or action that the conservative supremes could take than hiding Donald Trump's crimes or trying to hide them until after the election. I mean, unprecedented, absolute activist court. So let's just, you know, first. And then the second reaction I've had this nagging little voice in my mind of, where are all of my conservative coworkers that were outraged about Justice Protasiewicz's non-recusal on the redistricting case?
Yeah.
And now you have the federal Supreme Courts, some members of whom were appointed by Trump, others who are clearly beholden to him and have direct connections to the case and to the former president, not seemingly not recusing themselves. Maybe, maybe not. We don't know. But clearly, you know, moving forward with the case, it's just, I'm waiting for Mr. Voss's profile and courage
outrage
moment to say Clarence Thomas should not sit in judgment of this case. And so clearly you have this double standard, and it really harms our democracy. It really erodes the social contract that we have when, you know, think about it, Maggie. I mean, you and I, as attorneys, you go through law school really idolizing the Supreme Court, and you have to read the hundreds and hundreds of their decisions. And I've been there, and you walk in, and it's this really hallowed ground. And then you think of the kind of garbage that's going on the shadow docket and behind yes. closed doors and without accountability. It's really a sad day.
Yeah, I cannot square the call for Justice Protasiewicz to recuse with the silence as to Clarence Thomas's unquestionable refusal to recuse himself. His wife, Jenny, was texting the chief of staff of the criminal defendant. Let's just pause. Clarence Thomas's wife, leading up to and on January 6th, was texting the chief of staff of a criminal defendant whom her husband will now decide his claim to be immune from that criminal prosecution. That is called an actual conflict of interest. Justice Protasiewicz observing the facts related to our maps, which are basically mathematical realities,
right.
is not a conflict of interest. It's simply sort of breathtaking. Would you, and turning just for a moment to the actual merits of Trump's claim, it's truly outstanding in the worst possible. I don't mean like outstanding A plus.
Yeah.
I mean outstanding, like, what are you even talking about?
Think of the ramifications if the court were to entertain this argument and to say that a sitting president is immune from any kind of criminal prosecution. I mean, that is, it just must strike everyone listening as fundamentally unfair and un-American. It just really is a complete, I don't know. I mean, I it's just so fundamentally wrong that it doesn't seem like it's real. But I think in the current form of where we're at, I mean, if they had the opportunity to say no.
Right.
And they didn't. So
with this copious, lengthy, scathing, blistering opinion from the D.C. Appeals Court with a Trump-appointed judge as one of the appellate panelists that heard the arguments, where Trump's lawyer was asked, so the president could deploy SEAL Team 6 to kill a political opponent and he would not be subject to prosecution.
And it wasn't the city attorney of Milwaukee. That wasn't named. But
No. And the Trump's lawyer answered, yes, that's our legal theory. That's what we're asking you to endorse. Full immunity. I'm going to talk about the technicalities when we return. I know I've got to let you go.
I got to go win an election.
Stacked day today. I will tease this. I have asked you if you might be willing to guest host the show during my vacation coming up in March. So I'm just going to tease that out there for all of the Civic Media Land listeners, because you too, if you had questions, David from MechWan, I'm sorry we didn't get to you. You could call back up if indeed Mr. Goyke finds time in his busy campaign schedule.
I mean, I got to do it. Well, I certainly now I have to do it.
But, right, I've teased it.
I've been thinking about who I would have on as guests, and Maggie, I'm going to do it. I'm committing to doing it. I'm around. I mean, obviously I'm campaigning, but I'm around. I'm going to come in, and I'm going to get some of my Republican colleagues on.
That would
I think that would be fun.
And will you do me a solid, Evan? Will you ask them and help introduce me to them? Because I would really love to have some conservatives, in addition to some of our conservative callers, on the show to help engage. Because it's really important that we hear the counter argument, right? And just, hey, let's take up the issue. Let's have some meaningful, respectful, and kind back and forth. Because that's what government is supposed to be.
Absolutely. And in all my years in the legislature, there just is so few times I can think of where we had a real debate, like a real, you know, fact-based policy argument, which is why I got into it in the first place. And so, I'm coming on. Everybody tune in the week of March whatever.
The last week of March. One of those days, I will be sure to promote the heck out of it. So you know when to find Representative, now candidate from Milwaukee City Attorney's Office, Evan Goyke, on the Maggie Dawn Show. We'll have him on. He'll bring some of his conservative friends and colleagues.
Oh, it's going to be great.
It is going to be great because that's what we endeavor to do here. You know, folks used to call me somewhere in the sort of middle of the road because I talk about on the show all the time. Government should be effective and it should be dollar efficient. It should be transparent, accountable. It should be fair and even minded. And that used to be sort of this, you're fiscally a little bit tight fisted, but you don't believe government should be in bodies and homes, right? Yeah. And personal business, but socially liberal. That used to be sort of this, you're pragmatic kind of middle of the road gal. Now everybody's like, you're a rabid lefty. Well, because the whole paradigm shifted.
When everybody's falling off to the right.
I mean, a hallmark of that. Now, Mitch McConnell may have stepped down as Speaker of the Senate because of his health problems, but I think it's a harbinger of some of the things that we need to be concerned about. Kinzinger, Cheney, person after person. I'm going to blank on the congressional representative, the Republican from the Wisconsin delegation that's not going to run for re-election.
Gallagher.
Yeah. Thank you. That's shocking to me. Listen, I got to let you go. Thank you, Maggie.
It's been fun. Congratulations again. I look forward to sitting in your seat in a couple weeks.
That sounds great. Hats off to Representative Evan Goyke, now candidate for City of Milwaukee City Attorney's Office. That election's April 2nd. Back with more on the Supreme Court abomination after these important messages here on the Maggie Dawn Show. Yeah. Level up, level up, level up, level up, level up. So yummy, no, you want this yummy, yummy all in your tummy. Level up, level up, level up, level up.
Three little birds sat on my window, and they told me I don't need to worry. Summer came like cinnamon, so sweet. Little girls double dutch on the concrete.
Welcome back. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Some breaking news relevant to our last guest, State Representative Evan Goyke, candidate for city attorney for the city of Milwaukee. Breaking news. One of the current city attorney's top deputies is stepping down. It's just been a wild ride. If you don't know about what's going on in the city attorney's office, it's worth a read. Simply as a point of fact, in this larger context of, can we hold public officials accountable for doing their jobs well? You know, if you stink at your job, do you just get to blame everybody else? And I mean, stink at your job on some objective level. For the city attorney's office isn't a partisan office. It's like, get the law right. Understand your stakeholder groups. Meet the attorney's ethical standards. That's what you're supposed to do. Now, the deputy who's resigning basically had an allegation brought against him, against an investigation of some sort, that he was working in his private practice, you know, during business hours while he was getting paid by City of Milwaukee taxpayers. I'll just say this. That's not good. However, and this is a big point because I've done the work of a public servant in both the City of Milwaukee City Attorney's Office and as Milwaukee County's Chief Legal Officer for many years. I never worked 9 to 5. I was always working more than that. When I was getting ready for trials, I was working sometimes overnight. I took calls from clients any time of the day or night. If you're doing your job extraordinarily well, not everybody does, especially if you're in a position of leadership, you can't punch a clock. It's not the way it works. Clients call you when they need you. You can't do your job well as a lawyer if you're not available for clients when they need you. And listen, I don't think most lawyers are really great at this, are good at the client service part. I mean, most people I know get real ticked off about their lawyers. But I took that really seriously. So, listen, shouldn't have done that. But if he was doing his job at that top level, being available and making sure the work is getting done, he was not working in the regular 8-hour work shifts. He was working more than that. And you don't get paid overtime because you don't punch a clock. So it seems to me a lot of the investigation and hoopla around this deputy was simply because they couldn't do anything about the city attorney. I don't like it when people take out fall guys, do you? I mean, come on. But read about it for yourself. Come to your own judgment. There's tons of press about this out there. Again, elections on April 2nd. But before I was joined by my most excellent guest, who will be guest hosting the Maggie Dawn Show sometime during the last week of March, I'll let you know about that. I promised you that I would tell you more about why the Supreme Court can no longer be trusted with anything. And listen, if you're conservative, you want to call me up, tell me why. Oh, this is fine. It's fine that they're making sure that Americans will not see the evidence against Donald Trump before the election. If you want to come on this show, make an argument, you give me a call that that's a good thing. You call me. 855-75-CIVIC, because I do not think it is defensible. And the reason that this is going to hide the evidence against Donald Trump is that it is next to impossible for the trial to likely even begin before the election. And they have intentionally dragged their feet. You can't debate it. It took 2 weeks and 2 days for the Supreme Court to decide to take up the Colorado ballot case when the Supreme Court of Colorado kicked Trump off the ballot. 2 weeks and 2 days to decide to take the case and set the oral arguments and hear the oral arguments. 2 weeks and 2 days. What's the total time between request and when oral arguments are scheduled in the Trump tried to destroy democracy case? 10 weeks. 2 weeks and 2 days versus 10 weeks. And that 10 weeks is costly. He was supposed to start trial on March 4th, for crying out loud. Now the oral arguments won't even be had until April 22nd. And what are the oral arguments about? Well, gee whiz, is lawyers going to get up there and say, presidents can do whatever the heck they want, and they can never be held criminally accountable for it. That's not a principle of democracy. That's not what our country was founded on. All these constitutionalists, these textualists, we should do what the founders intended. I'm sorry, did the founders intend to create a king? 855-75-CIVIC. You call me and make an argument that it's a good thing that the American public will not see the evidence about this man's effort to overturn our democracy, because I want to hear what you got to say. I also want to hear what our friend Mark from Prairie du Sac has to say. Hi, Mark. Thanks for waiting.
Not a problem. And I'm going to say what I've said in the past. The president is not a king. As Hamilton pointed out in Federalist 69, that president is amenable to punishment and disgrace. And what is a disgrace is that the Supreme Court has actually taken up this case and not just tossed it out of hand. But we shouldn't be surprised when there's members on the Supreme Court now that don't believe in the 13th, 14th, 15th, or 16th Amendments. I think those were wrongly taken up and passed because we forced the former traitorous Confederate states to adopt those as part of becoming part of the Union. Sammy the Fish Alito actually goes back and it goes to the papal doctrine of discovery, which even the Catholic Church has repudiated. Now, and I guess a bunch of other churches now have repudiated the doctrine of discovery. and actually admitted that, well, the indigenous peoples actually do have rights.
Yeah, and clearly a little bit of a digression here, but if you look at sort of the encyclicals and the guidance coming out from the Pope in Rome now, it's about the environment, it's about working class people, it's about treating each human being with dignity. Those are the basic tenets of the Catholic faith. I don't know where Amy Coney Barrett, Alito, some of these other people are. I don't know where they get their definitions of Christianity from, but gosh darn. Thanks for the call, Mark. Appreciate you. So some of the questions that we had before were, what do we do about this? And there were some arguments that here we just have the Supreme Court doing its due diligence. So I need to answer those questions for you. And at the end of that, I'm going to start to paint a picture for you. I'm going to paint a picture about what does this mean if it all goes very wrong? Because that's, you know, when you talk about, oh, I don't like Trump, I don't like Biden, blah, blah. Yep, elections are sometimes about being an adult and putting on your big boy pants and making tough decisions between imperfect choices. But part of that analysis I would respectfully offer to each and every one of you is that you have to think about what happens if it goes really wrong under either candidate. In other words, do your downside risk analysis. I'm an economist as well as a lawyer. That's part of what we do. I'm going to paint that picture for you. You're not going to want to miss that. Because if you extrapolate out the arguments being made by MAGA Republicans and the far right of the GOP, and you say, snap our fingers, let's make that stuff reality, I want to ask each and every one of you, is that a world that you want to live in? Is that your America? Because I don't think it is. I don't think it is, no matter how conservative you are or how liberal or how disengaged with politics you may be. It ain't the world that I want to live in. But let's answer these questions. Folks talked about adding justices to the Supreme Court. I don't think you need to do that. You could do that. It's going to take a whole lot of doing. Highly unlikely to happen. So what's the alternative? The alternative is to continue to agitate for fair maps and for Congress to enact laws that dictate the rules of the Supreme Court. In other words, how they can take cases up, whether or not they can intervene, when they can intervene, the timetable in which they must act in certain cases. This would greatly curtail the current, completely out of control, unaccountable, zero transparency actions of this kangaroo Supreme Court, at least six of them. And that is Congress's role. What has happened because of the extreme gerrymanders when it comes to especially the Congress is that these legislative districts have become so red that folks don't need to actually be worried about legislating at all or getting anything done or finding compromise. It's exactly what Representative Goyke was talking about during this episode of my show. And when we have those extreme gerrymanders, when one person isn't equal to one vote, when the fix is in, whether for blue or red, folks, the elected officials, they go to the extremes. That is not good for democracy. And what you've seen here is Congress becoming more and more ineffective. They were well on that way before Donald Trump. They're completely there now. Best immigration deal Democrats have ever wanted, ever put before Republicans on the table right now. Mike Johnson won't move on it because Donald Trump told him not to, yanked his chain. So we need fair maps. We need to vote. We need Congress to rein in the out of control Supreme Court. Return the Supreme Court to its longtime historical lane, much more akin to where it was in the early 80s. Predictable, steady, not revolutionary, not deciding the outcome of elections. Since when do four Supreme Court justices get to potentially decide the outcome of an election? There's 340 million of us in the United States, and four people get to say you don't get to see the evidence? Why is that okay? CJ, why is that okay?
Thanks for taking my call, Maggie, because many of the hosts won't anymore.
I'm CJ, is that okay? Is that okay? Why is that okay?
You don't hear me? They aren't picking up. But thank you, because you have the courage to do
CJ,
so.
CJ, why is that okay?
You have to deem the Supreme Court illegitimate because you're going to pack the court.
I just told you, CJ, CJ, I just told you I don't believe in packing the court. Why is it okay for this court today to deprive every single American of the evidence against Donald Trump? If you believe in Trump, to deprive him of the right to prove his innocence, why is that good for democracy?
January 6th was not a truthful decision. You know, Nancy Pelosi won.
Okay. CJ, I have respect for you. I care for you. I want you to be well. I want you to be well informed. And I want you to be able to actually talk about what we're talking about. Until you can do that, my brother, I can't give you airtime. Because here's what we got to talk about. What does this mean for everybody here? This is not the Supreme Court doing its due diligence. It's the Supreme Court interfering in Americans' right to know, to be informed, to have the ability to make the best decision we can. And if CJ doesn't want to deal with that, I ask each and every one of you, we should be able to have a discussion about these things and stay on topic. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to start to paint you the picture. And I'm going to tell you why the picture matters after these important messages. Here's the picture as we start to paint it. Trump sees no trial on the federal charges before his election. And he is elected president in November. When we come back, I'm going to tell you the end of that story here on the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.
I was stronger. When you going to realize that you don't even have to try any longer? Do what you want to. Girl, put your records on.
You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. I promised you that I would help us all extrapolate out from this moment. From this moment where the Supreme Court loaded, packed, you want to talk about court packing, that court was packed by Donald Trump, a man who did not win the popular vote. I'm going to call that an illegitimate court. I'm going to call that a kangaroo court. From this moment when the Supreme Court decides to deprive the American public of our right to hear the evidence brought against a former president accused of the most serious crime any elected official has been accused of since the Civil War. And so those voters that might have been persuaded by hearing that evidence, those that would say a man convicted criminally of these sorts of charges I could never vote for, they don't turn out to the polls. Trump wins the election because of the gerrymanders that are still in place and the delay of games that that are happening in many places across this country. The GOP also takes control of the House and the Senate. We have a Republican-controlled federal government after the November election. what happens next when Donald Trump takes office on January 21st, 2025. He stops the two federal cases proceeding against him. He pardons every single January 6th rioter and co-conspirator and insurrectionist. He pardons every single one of the people who will pledge personal lifetime loyalty and fidelity to him. He appoints loyalists across every single federal agency. He removes longtime civil servants by getting rid of the civil service in the federal government. He makes immediate judicial appointments to all judicial vacancies. He crams through those appointments with a complicit GOP-controlled Senate. He eliminates all protections for federal employees. He eliminates federal pensions. And so those that he couldn't purge, they leave because they cannot work in that environment. You have a federal government now controlled and staffed by persons completely personally loyal to Donald Trump. He ousts all career prosecutors from the DOJ, puts in place personal loyalists. All crimes that are going to be prosecuted and investigated by the DOJ will be personally directed by Donald Trump. He turns the CIA, the FBI, and the national security apparatus on his political opponents. He bargains with dictators to enrich himself, to use the apparatus of the federal government, to use all taxpayer dollars to enrich himself by cutting deals with anybody who will do business with him. He uses every opportunity to use taxpayer dollars to benefit his companies. He exits the United Nations, NATO. He destroys our international partnerships with the entirety of the Western Democratic Alliance in Europe. He destabilizes Europe. China invades Taiwan. Russia completes its takeover of Ukraine and they start encroaching on Western Europe. Labor laws in the United States are gutted. The minimum wage is eliminated. Harassment and discrimination laws are rolled back. Abortion is banned nationwide. Gay marriage and all LGBTQIA plus protections eliminated on the federal level. Asylum is gone. Instead of increasing the number of administrative law judges to help process asylum claims, he reduces them by 80, 90%, bringing the entire immigration system to its knees. We become an isolated and closed country with no dependable allies except dictators and authoritarians. Free speech protections are weakened. Your local newspapers close. No one is asking elected officials hard questions anymore. The employer's obligation to provide health insurance to you and your family, that's gone. The National Labor Relations Board, he leaves vacant. Environmental regulations are effectively rolled back. Your water becomes polluted. The air you breathe polluted as well. PFAS spreads. The rates of cancer explode. The Voting Rights Act is repealed. It becomes the 21st century's version of Jim Crow in the United States. Religious organizations dictate public education. There is no longer a separation of church and state. Corporate taxation is rolled back to such a level that requires the federal government to scale back in all of its operations, including military defense. By huge margins. Books are banned. Libraries are cleared out. Habeas corpus is significantly weakened. Executions skyrocket. Gun regulation is now eliminated. And mass shootings increase drastically. Anyone who speaks out against President Trump is imprisoned . Oh, by the way, if he is immune, if the Supreme Court decides he's immune, he just kills his political opponents. What stands between us and this apocalyptic future? Not the institutions, not the Supreme Court, not the DOJ. Me and you and our vote. That is what protects democracy. Our democracy will be saved only by us and us fulfilling our democratic purpose. I'm Maggie Dawn. You've been listening to a special Thursday edition of the Maggie Dawn Show. It's time to get up and make your voice heard. Vote, America.